Please consider supporting Black Women United, YEG, for the protection and advancement of Black women and girls in Alberta. You can learn more about them at bwunited.ca. They are always looking for donations and volunteers. So please, again, support Black Women United, YEG, for the protection and advancement of Black women and girls in Alberta. Again, that website is bwunited.ca.
My name is Frank Silvestri. I'm from Philadelphia, Pennsylvania, not a Canadian. And Philly's really close to New Jersey, by the way. And I'm here to talk to you about why I am a Patreon supporter of Vish Khanna's Creative Control podcast, the unique long-form exploration of music, comedy, art, geography, and so much more. Vish is an incredible interviewer who has a charming, disarming, funny, reverently irreverent style, which feels a lot more like a conversation with friends than a podcast interview. These conversations have included talking to people like Jeff Tweedy, Nels Klein, Ira Kaplan, Dan Romano, Carson McCone, the white hot lung, Juliana Riolino, and one of my all-time favorites, the Sadies. So if you're like me and you find these kind of conversations vital, essential, and important, I hope you'll join me in supporting Creative Control on Patreon.
To make your flexible monthly donation to Creative Control, please visit patreon.com/creativecontrol today.
Jared Evan Sampson is a gifted and hardworking musician, songwriter, singer, and bandleader currently based in his hometown of Vancouver, British Columbia. Since 2012, Sampson has been the most consistent member of the prolific band Tough Age, which hopscotched across Canada for a spell, shifting musicians along the way, but maintaining Sampson's penchant for witty, heartfelt, and edgy underground pop songs. The latest Tough Age album is a wonderful one called Waiting Here, which was jointly released by We Are Time and Bobo Integral on June 16th, 2023, and prompted Jared and I to reconnect for a good talk about things like how we both left Ontario to move to Western Canada in recent years, a discussion about this region's unprecedented wildfire season in the summer of 2023, which was recorded before wildfires truly wreaked havoc in the Northwest Territories and British Columbia. Influential bands like Guided by Voices and REM and the Flying Nun Records roster, being very immersed in comics, and the debate about cinema versus superhero movies. A brief history of Tough Age, its cast of characters, and Jarrett's ability to maintain continuity. How Jarrett's bandmate Jesse Locke is doing these days. Working with new record labels, future plans, and much more. A part of the Entertainment One Network with the support of listeners just like you who follow and subscribe to this donor-driven podcast and spread the word about it and make flexible monthly donations at patreon.com/creativecontrol with additional support from Blackbird Music, a wonderful record store with locations in Edmonton and Calgary, Alberta, and very friendly people who work there. I just saw a couple of them on the weekend. It was great. I got some records. It was fun. You can get records from Blackbird as well. You don't have to live in Edmonton or Calgary where they have bricks and mortar locations. Just go to blackbird.ca, type in what you want. If they've got it in stock, they'll ship it right to your house. How do you beat that? Again, learn more at blackbird.ca. Plus in-kind support from Pizza Trocadero, The Bookshelf, and Planet Bean Coffee in Guelph, Ontario, and Granddad's Donuts in Hamilton, Ontario. This is episode 797 of Creative Control, featuring the lovely and talented Jarrett Evan Sampson from Tough Age, with your host, me, Vish Khanna. Hey, Jarrett, how's it going?
Hey, Vish, I'm good. How are you?
I'm well. It's nice to see you again and have you back on the show. It's been a long time.
I know. Guelph, we are both on the other side of this country since we last spoke.
That's right. I am from Ontario originally and was living in Guelph for the last time we convened for a radio broadcast slash interview thing. And at the time you were in Toronto, you were living in Toronto, right?
Correct. Yeah.
Yeah. So that was, how long ago was that? I don't even remember. I forgot to look. It's been then there's the pandemic, which I think of as one big year. So it's been potentially 6 years or something like that. Maybe,
I think it was Shame. So it's a few out, like three albums back, because we had an album in the pandemic. So it's same for me time frame wise. I'm always like, I don't know. It was a while ago, but I think probably, 2018, 2019, maybe at latest.
Yeah. And so, you know, this is a question I always ask people, but it's particularly germane. Where in the world are you as we're speaking, Jared?
I am at my first and new home back in Vancouver, BC.
Back in Vancouver. How are things going in Vancouver for you today?
So far, so good. It's a nice day. I live in a weird condo building. I live directly above a McDonald's that is currently venting fry smell into my apartment.
Oh,
that's
no.
Weird. It doesn't often happen. But yeah, other than that, everything is so far so good today. Yeah.
Oh, man.
How's Edmonton? How is Edmonton today?
Edmonton's fine. Yeah, it's good. I mean, it's the weather has been strange. It's been like extremely, as I'm speaking to you, we came out of like a very hot spell and now it got cold. My wife actually turned the furnace on from the air conditioner to the furnace setting on the thermostat, which I don't mean to brag, but we have both. And that's new for us. And this that's one of the reasons we moved. From Ontario, we couldn't get a good house and a roomy enough house. We did a 2-bedroom with 4 people. So we were like, we head west where the land is cheaper and the jobs are plentiful, because it turns out no one wants to live out here, I think is one of the reasons why. And but it's nice. I do like it. But yeah, it's been sort of up and down. And then you're in British Columbia, so I don't have to maybe explain this to you, but we've been talking a lot about smoke and fire. Mm. And so every day the air quality goes up and down, and they say don't go outside without a mask if it's not if it's above 7 out of 10, and then anything below that's okay. And it's very surreal and dystopian, and masks all the time for the air. Jared, don't you find that the air is not good all the time anymore?
It's very strange. Yes, yeah. I feel here. I kind of got here after the worst of it. It was pretty bad last year, and then. Now Ontario's getting hit, and I'm like, oh, my poor friends. Now, welcome. Here we go. The new world where you just like, is the air poison today?
Yes, it's very weird. So I will cop to that. That's been weird. But that's not an Edmonton thing. You asked about Edmonton, and you're right. I lived in Ontario my whole life before moving here in 2019, and can't recall air quality warnings due to smoke. And yeah. Everyone on the East Coast and Ontario and so it's everywhere. It's the whole planet. So but I first experienced this stuff coming here for the summers to visit my wife's family, and then thought that seemed like a good place to live. Remember that time we went there and like the whole second half of the week we couldn't do anything because it was smoky? Let's move there. And then now it's everywhere. So anyway, everything's relatively fine. I will say thanks for asking. Congratulations on the latest Tough Age album.
Thank you. Yeah, it's I'm happy it's out. It felt like the weirdest album release I've ever had, and I put my last one out during the height of the pandemic. So, yeah, it's really nice to have it out in the world. Yeah, thank you.
It's lovely. My wife and I were listening to it again today, and it's been playing in the house over the last week or so, and my wife finally made a comment. She's like, this is really, what is this? Are they from England? Where are they from? And I said, no, it's Tough Age from, she didn't know what it was. It was just playing while I was making everyone breakfast. And I said, no, it's a Tough Age from, I think they've got a New Zealand influence in a way. And I said that. And she's like, oh, okay. Now she's just picking up on something. And I don't know if it's about your voice. Does that resonate with you?
Oh, for sure. I mean, I think I was just going over that today. I think there's always about one song or record where I let myself get away with singing in a British accent. I mean, coming from loving Guided by Voices, you're like, hey, it's a fine move. But on the opening track, I definitely say like Rather. And I'm like, no, that's I'm from BC. That ain't me. But I mean, yeah, obviously New Zealand has always been a huge thing for me. I discovered so many of the like New Zealand Flying Nun and like Expressway and stuff bands when I was a teenager. because I was sort of in that wonderful era of music blogs.
Mm-hmm.
And there was the Kiwi Tapes blog and that I found through a Guided by Voices message board. And yeah, all this like amazing music that just, you know, as someone who likes the guitar, was like, oh, they're playing the guitar a lot better than other people in 1970s, 80s New Zealand. So, I mean, yeah, always the forefront still in my mind.
So not a British accent or a New Zealand accent, but a British Columbia accent. Is that a better way?
Yeah, that's, I think so, which I think tends to sound more American. People always think I'm American. Huh. I had that a lot in Ontario, too. Because of sort of the Cascadian effect. But yeah, as a singer, you're going to go British. It's just such a classic, like, pop rock accent, the British accent.
I know that that is sort of part of the album promotion, I suppose, like these sorts of influences. And then my wife, mm-hmm. as I say today, picked up on something from over across the pond. I can't help but pick up on like 80s REM. Is that even a thing for you?
Oh gosh, yeah, 100%.
Okay,
that's the one I think is funny because it's so overt to me. But I feel often you serve up what you want people to reference in your press release.
Yeah,
no knock on anyone, but they're like, I think I hear a little Yo La Tengo, and I'm like, well, yeah, because I mentioned them this album.
Yeah,
I hadn't mentioned them before, and all of a sudden it's everywhere. But REM, 80s REM, is one of my life changing things because when I was a kid, I don't understand albums, and I heard Losing My Religion. I'm like, I like that song. How do albums work? I'll buy this REM cassette or get my mom to. So that's 8 or 9 years old, and I bought Fables of the Reconstruction by mistake. And then
mistake.
Yeah, I didn't know. I'm like, REM, this is the band that does that religion song. Yeah. It's got to be on here.
Yeah.
So all of a sudden I'm 8 years old, and my favorite song is Maps and Legends. So yeah, 80s REM is... huge. And then a couple of Halloweens ago, we did an 80s REM specific cover set. Me and Wade is now playing in Tough Age, and Loren and Jesse. And yeah, we did like Chronic Town and stuff. Yeah.
Okay.
Love it.
So yeah. I am on the mark. I'm not off the mark. I noticed. Like,
you're
right on the mark. This is weird. I just had a conversation with recently with $100. They reissued their album.
Oh, yeah.
Forest of Tears, and we went on this REM tangent. I don't remember where it came from, but I mentioned that I recently, because my friend was selling all of his records, his mother was moving and blah blah blah, I have a vinyl copy of Out of Time by REM, which I've never owned on vinyl. And when I looked it up, I'm like, oh my god, people are paying an arm and a leg for that. I don't know if it's been reissued or if it's out of print, I was like, whatever, I just like REM, I'll just take whatever you have. I was just like, it was such a long list. I'm like, yeah, I'll take Out of Time. It seems like it's in decent condition. Anyway, that record just keeps coming up on my show, or that era of REM. And that's not what I'm hearing, by the way, on this record per se. So anyway, that's fascinating. Now I want to ask, we've talked about the hopscotching geographically across Canada. You mentioned that Vancouver is where you're from. Is that right?
Vancouver's where I grew up here, and then moved out on to Toronto.
And then you moved back. So let's get those are two very expensive cities to live in. So there's sometimes I talk to people of late, Jared, and they've moved from a metropolis to like a smaller or slower sort of area of the country, and things are a little more affordable. These sorts of things, and affordability seems to come up a lot. The material conditions of being an artist in this day and age. But like I say, you went from Vancouver, which on any given day is the most expensive city to live in Canada, to Toronto, which on any given day is the most expensive city to live in Toronto, in Canada. Sorry, I'm misspeaking.
Yeah.
Anyway, I'm kind of making jokes. Let's just talk about why you moved to Toronto in the first place, and then obviously why you decided to move back to Vancouver.
Yeah. I think that somewhat uniquely, not to position it, says, oh boy, but most people I knew living in Vancouver, especially through art scenes, came here. And they would have grown up even, say, in like Campbell River or Salmon Arm or somewhere and come to the city for school. But I grew up in Vancouver.
Right.
So my parents moved here from Winnipeg when I was 3 months old. So they moved at a time when it wasn't unaffordable. And so I was here. So again, all my family is also still here, which I think is often part of the
family
when people move.
Sure.
I have, my parents are both here in the city. My brothers are both, they're out a bit because of this affordability, but, you know, Squamish and Coquitlam, so very close at hand. So everyone was here. And then similarly, when we moved to Toronto, Penny is from Toronto, grew up in Toronto, family from the city. So we moved back because her mom and her siblings were there, and they have all since left. None of them are still living in Toronto now. But yeah, that was her upbringing as well. So when we went to move, she had actually, and I'm sorry to all my friends in the lovely city of Ottawa, but she had wanted to move to Ottawa, and I said, I'm not moving to Ottawa. So Toronto was sort of the compromise because Penny didn't enjoy growing up there. But same, I felt I didn't enjoy growing up here.
Yeah.
And then I'm back and I'm enjoying it much more. But Toronto was sort of the compromise.
I just want to interject because I laughed at you. I have friends in Ottawa, lovely friends.
Yeah.
I've enjoyed playing in Ottawa as a musician and visiting Ottawa. But I've talked about this on the show. It's came up recently with the artist Kai Brooks, who spent time living in Ottawa. And we talked about how there's like a chip on people's shoulders in Ottawa. I feel like there's often a chip on people's shoulders in Canada who don't live in Toronto, because Toronto gets a lot of attention. Ottawa gets a lot of attention. It's the political capital of the country. So people focus a lot of resentment on Toronto and Ottawa when they live outside of those cities. When you said to Penny, who, by the way, for those listening, Penny is your partner, is that correct?
Yeah, it's my wife.
Your wife. And
who was in Tough Age and is
no longer in Tough Age. And I want to ask, we'll get into membership changes because it seems like it's been a lot of musical chairs, quite literally. and we'll get into that. But when you say to Penny, I do not, under any circumstances, and I'm putting words in your mouth now, want to live in Ottawa, Ontario, what, why? Why did that come to your mind at that time?
I have so many wonderful friends. Playing there is always great, but part of the unaffordability you were talking about growing up around is I've always had a day job, and I've always worked. I've worked full time since I was 15.
Yeah.
In other fields, and I like that because it sort of allows me to do what I want with my art. Ottawa is not a city that I could move to and find employment in the very niche fields that I am employable in, and I do not speak French, because one of the other problems about growing up out west is they let you drop out of that as soon as you want. And they're like, oh, go take Spanish. Go take Japanese. I'm like, sure, let's explore that. Now I will be fluent as a teen in nothing.
Right.
Great.
Right.
So Ottawa, especially a city, so many jobs and people I know work in fields that require, you know, speaking both languages. And I can't do that. I couldn't get by. I can't make it in Ottawa. I can make it in Toronto because I know how to live in a city that just hates that you're there so much. They're like, get out of here. Like, I'm staying. Like, you can't get rid of me. I'll make what I want in this oppressive city. But a city that sort of like allows you to live, I'm like, oh, I'm going to drown.
That
I'm not good enough.
That's fascinating. That's fascinating. The more accommodating the city is to its citizens, the less you feel like you can thrive.
Oh, for sure. Yeah.
You need adversity. You need some, you know, disconnect, I suppose. Just for my own interest, and I suppose other people listening, when you describe your vocational attributes and strengths, this isn't a job interview, by the way. What is your core sort of skill set, if you will?
Well, that's a good question. I essentially work in events planning at this point, but I've worked in comics since I was in my early 20s. So I've worked in comic shops and then on comic festivals. I worked in Toronto at the comic shop The Beguiling Books and Art, and for the Toronto Comic Art Festival. I'm the kind of guy then also threw all the shows in the Beguiling basement because I'm like, oh, this looks like a space you can do shows. So I came back here to take the position as festival director for the Vancouver Comic Arts Festival. So I know a lot about comics, but I don't make them. So that's sort of my career. And then before that, I worked at Rogers for years when I was young. Rogers Video, but I moved into sort of like merchandising at Rogers Video and realized I hated that. So I like working in like the arts still, which also doesn't pay you that well.
Yeah.
As you believe, you know.
Yeah.
And but it kept me going. And so I think those scenes, like, you know, it's a good vocation to be struggling a little bit because you kind of condense and find that scene in a city that big. Like, you're going to find it. And that's, like, Toronto, the comic scene in Toronto is, and music, too, are both so amazing, yeah. I think, because of that oppression. The city that's like, leave. Move to Hamilton at best.
That's right. That's a lot of what seems to happen in Ontario. That kind of migration, I suppose, to slightly smaller but still big cities. So you are interested in comics but are involved in a kind of administrative aspect of it. Are you an illustrator at all? Nothing.
I have no skill sets, which some could say has not stopped me to pursue other artistic endeavors. But yeah, I really love comics. Comics and music are the things I love. But for me in comics, because I know can organize, I really like being in positions where I can take all that off and like for people in those roles. And that's something too why I like throwing shows, is I like to take on these things like responsibilities or roles to assist other people in like flourishing. And music, I feel I can do both. Comics, I'm just a really good retailer. I'm really good at setting up the events. I can, you know, solve a problem, like put a fire out at, you know, if something's going on. Yeah, I like that. It's sort of just like a way to enable and help people in communities, and very often also lead to paying them in my current job, which I love so much.
You like paying people?
I love paying people, and I love not giving notes.
Oh, yeah.
Because I'm self-aware enough, yeah, to know if someone hired me to make music and then said, oh, what if? I'd be like, okay, well, bye. Guess you don't want the music, right? Why would you ask me to change?
Very good. No, that's good. You know yourself. That's good to, you know.
I try to.
Yeah. You know, as we're speaking, and I don't mean to go on a great tangent here, but as we're speaking, there is a real dialogue about comic books in film. And whether or not that's a good or bad thing for filmmaking. I'm sure you're aware of, you're on the Twitter, I see it all the time. So I'm
sure,
or on social media, maybe even at this point. But yeah, I'm sure you're familiar with Martin Scorsese's opinions and how that's been memed and whatnot. Scorsese is among the, and Coppola, the old school filmmakers are among the ones being like, it's fine if you like comic book movies, but this is not cinema, these kinds of terms. And then they get backlash for being too highfalutin. And, you know, I have instituted a movie night in my house. And everyone in my family, so there's my wife and two young children, and we all get a shot at picking a movie. And, you know, we just went through the Indiana Jones quadrology. I don't know what the name of a four movie thing. We haven't watched the new one yet, but those are kind of comic book oriented, but I'd never thought of them that way as a kid. They were just cinema and good movies. But when my son in particular would be like, let's watch a Marvel movie, I'm like, okay. And then at some point, I have like Martin Scorsese on my shoulder being like, this isn't really a movie. And then I got it. Now I'm like, yeah, is this a movie? Sorry, this is where I'm coming from. I've seen them all. I enjoy them. But when I get into the dial into like, is this actually filmmaking or is this just all computer imagery and explosions all the time? You know, there's every once in a while like a little bit of a joke, a little bit of dialogue. Anyway, I'm really being reductive. What is your take in your community, maybe, about the mainstream discussion about the significance of the rise of comic book films and their success? And now, I think, like all movies, their failure. What do you make of what's going on in terms of comics in the pop culture these days?
Well, it's interesting because the comics communities that I'm in are actually very like adjacent to that, but very more like the highfalutin side of comics, right? Like the same sort of thing. Like they're drawn in quarterlies, your Fantagraphics, doing stuff that's like the same idea, like the Martin Scorsese's of the comic book world. But yeah. I obviously came to that from being like, I like when Spider-Man punches someone. And I have a great love of those comics still as well. That was one of my unique qualifications at The Beguiling, well regarded as like the snobbiest store of all time, is that I could work on the main floor and talk about like all that stuff and be like, oh, you want to come down and get an art comic, but I can also tell you what happened in Amazing Spider-Man number 372.
Yeah.
The movies I think are absolute hot garbage and I don't even watch them anymore.
Okay. All right.
Every now and then one breaks through, but like it's the monkey's paw reality where if you had told me as a child, like they're going to make a Black Widow movie and you're not even going to watch it because you don't care. I'm like, I will be there opening night.
Yeah.
I also think there is a thing sometimes, and I have sympathy as someone who makes sort of ostensible dumb music and thinks about it a lot. You know, I said, like, the music you're allowed to consider art is like noise music, or like, I mean, like, and it is like Bill Orcutt. That's art. But if you're in a band playing guitars, they're like, well, that's not art.
Yeah.
But I think about it a lot. But I do think there's like a rub where people are like, what I like also has to be the best, or has to be intelligent. And as a kid, I was so interested in film too. And like 16, going to the Cinematheque here in Vancouver and watching like every Ozu movie and being like, this is incredible. Or like all the documentaries of Nicholas Flaubert and being like, this is art. I was still going home and watching Hard Target on TBS. Yeah. And I'm like, I love this movie so much. Yeah. But I wasn't like, I wasn't writing, you know, being like, this is so, I'm so smart and people don't appreciate this. It's the same. I'm like, well, it's great, but they're not, they don't have to be the same level. And comic book movies, I think, became that so much. This idea as well that like Scorsese's just like, I mean, and then all that reduction of like, well, he masculine stereotypes. I'm like, go watch Silence and tell me, you know, like you've seen one of his movies. And then they made a Scorsese comic book movie and it was awful. That Joker movie. I'm like, oh boy. Whew. It's sort of like,
they remade The King of Comedy as Joker. Is that what you mean?
Yeah. It's just so clearly like inspired by those, are trying to be Taxi Driver, or those early like Mean Streets, even a little bit.
Well, Joker is clearly King of Comedy. Like, clearly, yeah. I mean, they cast De Niro in it, for crying out loud, as Jerry Lewis's character. And
can't I just have King of Comedy and a Batman movie? Like, why do they got to be together?
Do you think there is a high, okay, so here's a thing, as I say this stuff to you, for family movie night, we couldn't pick something, and I don't remember whose choice it was, but we wound up watching the Sam Raimi Spider-Man, the Tobey Maguire Spider-Man. And then my daughter liked it so much that we spent the next day on this, as Jared and I are speaking, it was a long weekend in Canada. We uncharacteristically had a second consecutive movie night, and we watched Spider-Man 2. Very entertaining. Somehow, what are those from? Like the mid-2000s or something? Or just after 9/11,
early 2000s,
I think. Yeah. So I enjoyed them, and they felt smart, and they felt like they had a good story. And then weirdly, Superman 2 was on the television, which was a big movie for me as a kid. Mm-hmm. Makes absolutely no sense. Nothing, as I was watching, nothing they're doing makes, why would he do that? Superman trips and falls? Why would Superman, even as Clark Kent, trip and fall and give his identity away? That didn't make any, and nothing made any sense. But do you think there was a high point for these kinds of films? Because, and I don't know if you care for them or are going to buy what I'm saying, but I found the Christopher Nolan Dark Knight trilogy, Batman trilogy, to be very engrossing. I still watch them from time to time. I'm rewatching that show Succession on the HBO. I
just started watching that.
You've never seen it. I'm realizing now from the shots and the music and the way the tension swells in this drama about finance and family, I feel there's a huge influence from Christopher Nolan on that series that I haven't heard anyone really ever talk about. And specifically, like, there's all these, like, crane shots of the cityscape, or drone shots, I should say, these days, of the cityscape at night and swelling music. And it really, I'm like, holy shit, this is like, this reminds me, why does this remind me of The Dark Knight? These black cars driving in the New York streets. Anyway, sorry, I'm really on several tangents but do you think there's a high watermark for that, where the cinema part, like the purest cinema and storytelling and the comic book worlds kind of have collided in any unique way?
Well, I think those Spider-Man movies are good because they understand they're adapting Spider-Man comics. So they're kind of ridiculous. And Sam
there's something
does
fun
a lot
about
of ridiculous
them.
Ridiculous
yeah.
things.
Yeah, yeah.
Now it's sort of like, again, it's just, like, for me now it's sort of, and actually the Christopher Nolan Batman movies I can't stand for a similar reason.
Okay.
I don't like them because it feels, it's like, what if these characters were just like the military? I'm like, like the military. Less so on that one. And I do appreciate the Christopher Nolan movies' dedication to ridiculous voices.
Yes.
I really enjoy that. But I
and putting Tom Hardy in masks.
He was
Bane, and then in Dunkirk, I'm like, is he Bane again? I don't know if you've seen Dunkirk, but he's flying around, and most of the movie, he's wearing a mask, and I'm like, poor Hardy, like he can't ever show his face in a Christopher Nolan movie. Yeah.
That's the takeaway from those for me, is like me and Fran just being like, and this gives you power over me? And you're like, I love his ridiculous voice, and he committed. So, and I think they're even like him, like Venom. I saw Venom. I had been in Japan when it came out for about a month, and I wasn't yet fluent enough to really speak, and I hadn't had a good conversation, and I watched Venom, and it was a weird reintroduction to hearing and understanding the language that you speak, and I loved his commitment. So I'm like, that might be my high water mark. It's right. it's like a Laurel and Hardy movie. It's ridiculous. Right. Yeah. But as for actual good movies, I don't know. I mean, I like that first Superman movie a lot.
The first one with Marlon Brando, and that one's good. I like that one.
I like those ones quite a bit. But I don't know. I mean, I think as a kid, I just like, I was reading all those comics and I was still going to see The Human Condition.
Yeah.
And it's like, these are two things that I can take in.
Yeah.
I wonder. Yeah. Well,
and the first, maybe I will say, so I was 11 or 12 when the Tim Burton Batman came out. And I think that really relaunched this notion of these movies after the Superman series kind of petered out. Superman 4 and 3 and 4 were quite, so the Batman movie came out, and I was telling my wife, I still at my parents' house, I have the Batman cereal box, I have the Batman giant slushy slurpee cup, and I have all I had everything, I had magazines, I loved it, and that's my guy. So I appreciate what you're saying about the Nolan thing, and I hadn't really pondered how militaristic it was. But again,
I'm like, everything everyone enjoys, no one's right or wrong about any piece of art, I feel. And that's maybe also the thing on that. I'm like, all art is subjective. You like it or you don't.
Yeah.
I don't like when people grandstand. And I think like when you're passionate, you often sound like you're saying something's wrong. But it's like, again, I love Hard Target. Like, it's a great movie.
Yeah.
You know, stuff like that. There's lots of terrible things that I love so much.
I watched Twins the other day. Yeah. Twins.
Oh, God. Yeah, I love Twins.
It's good.
It's ridiculous.
It held up somehow. We were like, it's actually pretty good. So anyway, sorry, quite a number of tangents there. But I wonder if your immersion in comic books and comics has influenced you as a songwriter or as a musician in any particular way. I can't at the ready suggest I can see some parallels or connections, but what about you? Do you think it's helped you or informed your narrative skills or your writing in any way?
For sure. I mean, outside of even if you look at the art on our albums has gone even from me doing collage of old romance comics on the first cover to then from Shame On, it's all been comic artists, as Patrick Kyle did the cover to Shame. And Connor Willemsen, another great artist, did the cover to Which Way Am I? And then Hugh Nguyen just did our cover for Waiting Here. All amazing comic artists. And I also, in the writing, I think when I was young, I was really into continuity. And in comics, one of the things I loved as a kid is I'd just go to the comic shop and buy an issue of Daredevil. And you're reading it, and he's like, the last time I met Stiltman. You're
right.
Like, what? And there's a little note, and it says, see Daredevil number 182.
Yeah.
And then I'd be like, I got to find that one and, make a list. And I think similarly, a thing that I would never expect people to pick up on, but as I said, I think a lot about my ostensible, dumb guitar music. There's a lot of connections and through lines and story songs where there's other songs about the same characters from one's past, or even on this album, I mean, our new album opens with a song that is another version of the song that closed our last album in a new form. So continuity was a big thing that I really liked, and sort of like having these small connectors within my work that you can still enjoy. And I mean, I think everyone can enjoy though picking up on them, because I doubt anyone ever has. But that's a real thing that comics taught me or gave me a love of, is that I guess also reading CD booklets as a kid, is there's always deeper you can dig, and there's something, there's a connection that you may not be seeing that doesn't subtract but can add if you want to build the world for yourself.
So not exactly Easter eggs, but Easter eggs are an interesting concept, because for those unfamiliar with something, they never know that it was an Easter egg. They just accept it.
Yeah.
But for those who are deeply immersed in a world of comics or bands, And liner notes were huge for me also as a kid. I would read them voraciously just because I thought, you know, even the thank yous, like, oh, they're thanking so-and-so. Who is that? And then you'd learn more about that producer or that so-and-so. So, yeah, so they become Easter eggs to the fanatics among us, I guess. Like, wow, the Tough Age is starting their new album with basically the same song they ended their last one with. That's that's a little nod to me as a fan, as a follower. It's a little treat, right?
Yeah, I think that, continuity and Easter eggs are very similar.
Yeah.
And just that through line. Hi, Penny.
Yeah, I see Penny in the background there, walking around to your place there.
Yeah.
It's probably drawn to the French fry smell. Where is that coming from? I got to get some food.
Oh, yeah. I know, I'm aimed right at our whole apartment. This is the downside of moving back to Vancouver. You live in 400 square feet.
Yeah.
But yeah, I think those have a similar notion to it, where, it's something and it isn't going to skip the needle if you don't get it. But yeah, just something laid that if you're paying attention or cared to figure out that there's something to pick up on. And I think maybe the difference is with the continuity, there's ones people would never pick up on unless I said. And that's, say, like, to me, there's a song on our second album called Castigation. And then the character, one of the characters from that song, is also the protagonist of the song Possession on Which Way Am I?
Right.
And there's no way to know that. But when I'm writing it, is I'm still referencing back to that. So, yeah, I just find that interesting for myself.
Super fascinating. And I guess I wasn't sure as I lobbed this question out if comic books might influence a musician and a songwriter. But clearly it has. Like that narrative.
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay.
I really like drawing, even outside of music or anything, I like to draw inspiration for what I'm doing, not from things that are very parallel to what I'm making.
Yeah.
So even it's like, like I love 80s R.E.M., I love The Laws, and these are things I'm thinking of sonically making the record. But when I'm making my records, most of the time I'm listening to harsh noise and like folk music, like Morris dancing.
Oh.
I'm really into like the rhubarb right now, like Afghani rhubarb. I'm like... Like, that's what I'm listening to when I'm making pop music.
Right.
And so, similarly, I like to think about, like, books I've read and, comics and things. So, for sure, it's a huge influence on, like, how I shape what I'm doing.
You contain multitudes is what I'm hearing, and that's great. No, that's nice. That's good to hear. Speaking of continuity and characters, I want to get back to what I was saying earlier about the membership changes. And even it sounds like, and I don't know enough about this, so I want to leave it to you. It sounds like the continuity in Tough Age is that you are reconvening with people that you used to play with in moving back to Vancouver and in these sorts of things. So you got a job in Vancouver, and that's why you left Toronto. But the band membership has also changed as of this record or recently. You know what? Again,
I'm
misspeaking. Can you talk about the membership of Tough Age now and sort of where it has changed in recent years?
Yeah. Also, I just need to go back and acknowledge that was an all-time good transition into talking about this. That was a really good segue.
The character and continuity thing?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Man, that was great.
I'm a semi-professional at this point.
You are a very professional, but that was still, I was like notably very good segue.
I appreciate that. I like a good segue. And when you don't have any notes, you have to listen. That's my thing. I got to listen. And all the questions are in whatever you said. And then I realized, whoa, eureka. I got a segue on my lips here, on my tongue, tip of my tongue. I can't wait to do this segue. So thanks for pointing that out. We're getting a little meta.
I mean, I think the lineup has changed so many times. And I really, it's part of personal growth too, is I think in the beginning, we started in Vancouver, it was myself and Penny, and Loren, who's back playing bass, and our friend Chris Martel on drums. And that was the first two records, the core lineup. But even within that time, Penny had gone temporarily to Ottawa. So my friend Jay Clisby, I used to play in Apollo Ghosts with, had joined on guitar for a while. And then you'd go on tour, and Chris couldn't go on tour. So our friend Mac, who plays in lots of bands, is in Joe Past, some other things, would come on tour. Then we go on a bigger one. Our friend Kate is going to come play drums. And then, Penny's back. And so Jay is going to do this. And, like, it just, like, kept changing. So when we moved to Toronto, I had this idea that we would still keep it going and sort of do tough age West, tough age East.
Yeah.
But in hindsight, that's also a very selfish way to do it. It's like I get to have every version, and I was taking something from the people on the West Coast and not extending full band status to the people on the East Coast. So at that time, it was the old band, and then in Toronto, we were playing with Jesse and our friend Paul, Paul Otten. And then I was like, this is not sustainable. We had gone on a big tour, and I kind of just had to be like, we need to figure this out. We had had someone leave because they didn't like that. And you're like, I got to figure this out. So we reconvened and just became Penny and Jesse and I. And that was sort of like a weird decision. Or I was like, is it a different band? What do we do? But I still really felt like it was the continuation of what I had been doing. As the years have gone on and having gone through all this again, I'm like very much more come open to the idea of a band as that group of people. And I think of something like a band like The Bats has just been the same four people for 40 plus years, and they just do it. And there's such a power in that that I felt I was losing by acknowledging that I love the personalities that bring something to your music, because it changes it in ways you'd never make the same song with the same person playing bass on your music. Well, like I needed to recognize how much that meant to me and stop being selfish and being like, I want to keep going. I want to do this. So we had had that three piece lineup and became just Penny and Jesse and myself. And we did our last album, and then the pandemic hit right after I'd done a U.S. tour visa, which is money down the toilet.
Man, yeah.
And during that, that as well, like Penny had been playing in with Jesse as well in Chandra, in the band Chandra.
Oh, yeah.
And they had done some bigger things. I always like to repeat when they played Primavera Sound and I was at home in Toronto. She was like about to go on stage and I was eating cheese in my underwear. I was like, there you go.
Yeah.
But so Penny, I think, just also Tough Age had always been at a level where it didn't allow a lot of forward momentum career-wise to take next steps. And she was feeling like we were just in this valley that kept her from making music in a smaller scale or a bigger scale, because we were never going to go bigger. So I could sort of feel like she really wanted out for a while. And Penny and I's communication is usually amazing. Like Penny is the greatest person I know, and our relationship is the foundation of my life. And it was very strange to be like, but I feel like you don't want to play music anymore. And she wouldn't really commit to it. And that was during a lot of the making of the last record. So I had sort of decided, especially as we contemplated moving back to Vancouver, like this is going to be it, because I'm not going to go back, find another drummer. Like Jesse is now, I mean, after me, been in the band the longest, and like someone whose artistic connection and collaboration means so much to me. So this is it, probably. And so I sort of wrote the last album as a backdoor final record. And then Jesse ended up moving to Vancouver, even before we did.
Right.
Jesse said, like, hey, I'm moving to Vancouver. And we're like, oh, okay. So all of a sudden, I'm like, hey, there's a future. And then when we got here was finally when Penny was like, I just don't think I can keep doing music in this way. Mm-hmm. So she was out, and I was like, who knows? And I've been friends with Loren this whole time, and I love Loren, and I just think is like one of the most wonderful people I know, such an amazing musician. And I was really like, I wonder if we can play music more readily together again. And all of a sudden Jesse and I were just like, what if we did this? So we reached back out, brought back in, and it was the three of us. And I was like, this is it. This is the final one. The old version and the new version all together.
Yeah.
We are Tough Age. And then I still had an idea that would be the end. And Loren is the one who called me on it, where she was like, why would I want to be in a band if you're telling me like we're done, or yeah, you're telling me we're finished? And it was the final pillar of like, I want to collaborate with people. Nothing has to be finite. And then since then, we asked our friend Wade to join the band. So we're working on new material now with a fourth member again for the first time in 8 years. I'm very long-winded about this. I'm sorry.
No, it's like, fine. You're on the right show. You're on the right show to be long-winded. Don't worry.
Yeah. I had a real long journey, and I'd hope so. You grow up a lot. I mean, when I started this band, I was in my mid-late 20s, and now I'm in my late 30s. You would hopefully be in a different place with yourself.
Yeah.
And it became much more, yeah, that I don't want a band to be like me and your granny on bongos, like the Marquis Smith philosophy. Mm-hmm. I really want it to be collaborative, but I don't have to keep putting these parameters on what that means. But so for me, like tough, like band names all just become wallpaper. You've had them for a year.
Sure.
There's no good or bad band name anymore. Like this is the, I just like am hanging out with these people and we make music and we're putting it out under this name and it's not me. And that was the final thing is like, it's not me, this is us.
Yeah.
So we get to decide how this goes forward. And that was a real long process. And part of like something that I think having people come in and out was the only way I could learn it, because you learn how indispensable people are by treating them as dispensable.
Yeah.
By sort of saying like, I got to keep going. You're like, but it's not the same. I need these people.
Yeah. You're not the first person I've heard of to do a kind of sort, well, not bi-coastal exactly, but I remember famously, and this also came up on that $100 episode. This is so strange. John Ray Fletcher had a John Ray and the River in British Columbia and then moved to Toronto and had a new John Ray and the River with Anne from the BC version, also moved to Ontario, I think, to be a part of it. And then he split Toronto and headed back for different reasons and is now very much making... I don't even know if he's making music publicly, so to speak.
Yeah.
So there's some to that, maybe. I just draw this parallel because you're not the first I've heard of to go on this journey eastward and then decide to come back and keep the band going in some capacity, if you will.
Mm-hmm.
So there's some to that, and I appreciate your humility and self-awareness. Like, it's not about me. It's about everyone. No, that's cool. I appreciate that. And I like the fact that, like, I'm happy for you that you were able to convene a version that was sort of the two worlds and that you had the good fortune that Jesse... Is Jesse from British Columbia originally?
No, Jesse's from Calgary.
Oh, he's from Alberta. Okay, right.
Yeah.
I think I knew that. So the luck you had in that Jesse moved from Ontario to Vancouver. That's amazing. Like, what are the odds of that? So,
and that was sort of the first step on that, because Jesse had become like, I can't do this without Jesse. Like, Jesse is like, Jesse and I, like, we've been so close collaborators for so long.
Yeah.
And so I was like, that's got to be it. So all of a sudden it was like, oh, okay, no, if Jesse's still around, maybe
that's
maybe
great.
We got something.
Yeah. I know that Jesse has had some struggles in recent times. How's he doing?
He's doing well. I think I saw him, I haven't seen him, I guess, last week, but, you know, I've been really like working with him and helping him through it. We've been, especially like, he's taking a break from playing live. So, Jay Arner is playing drums live for us at the moment, which has also been a lot of fun because Jay and I have known each other forever and I think so much of him.
Jay's one of my favorite people, I would say. We don't talk very much, but I really love him and his sensibility, and we became big fans of his music in my house when my kids were younger, and he was very kind with my he and Jess came and it was around the same trip that we're talking about, I think, right
I remember. So, they were hanging out with your kids.
They were very sweet. Anyway, sorry, I didn't mean to interrupt you. That's lovely.
No. But yeah, I mean I love Jay. I've known Jay forever. Jay is like he's been involved in every Tough Age record, recorded the first one, has always either played something or then mastered or been involved. Like, I think, I respect and love him so much. So it's really great to have him doing that. And we're still like working on new stuff and fitting that in with Jesse. But it was important to me as well, like, because he struggles with health things that are also issues I've gone through myself.
Yeah.
That I didn't want to give finish lines. I want to be there with him and keep working on it because I kept saying to people for 7 years, I was in a band, a lineup of Tough Age that was just me, my wife, and Jesse.
Yeah.
So clearly he's pretty important to me.
Yeah.
You know, someone like that, at the same level that you can be like, I'm with my wife, this third guy can be here. That'd be lovely.
I mean, as a GBV fan, as a Guided by Voices fan, I imagine you're not unaware of the fact that a lineup can change, but the songs and the music can carry on. And that people might come and go. I mean, that maybe.
But also,
is that too on the nose? But I feel like that might be a parallel.
No, but I think that also is what taught me how those different lineups influence and impact so much.
Yeah.
Because, I've seen Bob or GBB like 62 times live or something like that. when I was a teen, I was before the first retirement electrifying conclusion, which I was at, I was going underage in the States to all the, like, I was following them around.
Nice.
So my first show would have been like Universal Tours and Cycles underage in Vancouver at Richards on Richards. And even then was, I think, Jim McCann was on drums. And then the next time, Kevin March is on drums. And then I go and see the Robert Pollard solo shows, which is, he had just this nuts band for those. It's like him, Tommy Keane, John Worster, Jason Arducci, and I can't remember the other guitarist's name. I know he played with like Frank Black, and I can't think of his name.
Wow.
I'm sorry.
No, it's fine.
But just like all these shows, they're incredible. But they play GBB songs, and they obviously sounded very different from that other lineup. And then I saw the Classic Reunion, and they played those songs very different. And then you see the new lineup, and like Doug's back, but like it still sounds different because everyone else in the band is different. Yeah. So I think like maybe before I was like, see, you can just get whoever you need. But also from that, I'm like, but it totally changes the personality of the music who's playing it.
Built to Spill is a similar, very similar example as well. Yeah, it's interesting. That's interesting. I am someone who believes in band chemistry and, you know, as someone who likes superhero teams to some extent, I like the notion that a band is a band, but I also like the notion of what we're talking about, that the material can and the personalities involved, those can be a guiding light and carrying things forward, and it can still be impactful, and it's different, but it's the same. It's like a warped, yeah. I like that. So I'm glad we landed on that, and I appreciate your insights into it. Given all the kind of stuff we've talked about, this record is called Waiting Here, and I wonder if you can, in a general sense, talk about whether anything we've just discussed, the movement, the pondering of feelings of your bandmates, you know, what life is these days with Penny's departure, is there, from the band, I mean, is any of that informing your songwriting on this record?
Oh, yeah, for sure. So
it's a lot. I know.
Yeah. So Waiting Here was a song, too, that I had just put up on Bandcamp a few years ago that we had recorded with Penny the bed tracks of. And then I recorded the rest, which is why it's sort of lo-fi versus the rest of the album. And I really wanted it as the capper. But I had done it, and it was like supposed to be the next, we were going to self-record and do this thing that was right after Which Way Am I? And then the pandemic happened, and you're like, well, that plan's on hold. And that was really it. I'm like, I'm waiting. And the idea of not yet having achieved where you're going, or just being stuck in sort of stagnation, like waiting for things to resolve, which unfortunately became a big thing around this whole album anyways, became much bigger, was sort of the concept of the record. It was like, how do you get stuck in place from both externally and internal pressures? So a lot of the lyrical themes on the record are around like, yeah, the idea of being stuck waiting and like being like, when is things going to happen? Or even, you know, the opposite is the song Getting Closer, which is very long and told you, I think, too much about it. The vocals come in so far into it, it's like you have to wait and wait and wait for that to come. And it's all about, like, when are we going to get there? And so it is very, it's like so much of the lyrical theme of the record is all around, being stuck in place.
I see. Okay, so...
And that's how the name came about. I didn't know what to name it. And I think it was even Penny was like, it seems like it's called Waiting Here.
So some measure of, I think, anticipation, but restlessness and uncertainty and all these sorts of things, I guess. Yeah?
Yeah, and that's like, you know, we this is our first album not for Mint Records, and that was a thing too where it was just like, oh, like, is it even going to come out? Like, who's going to do it? Are like, we were the motivation the other way. We're like, well, we love this album. We're going to put it on cassette and sell it ourselves if that's what we have to do. But saying it was like the delay of like, oh, you know, you expect something's happening a certain way and then it changes. And it sort of everything like that is just a knock on, or you kick the can down the road for the finish line. And so it's like every stage of this has been like that. And then even through this, because we were with everything that was going on with Jesse and with figuring out where it was coming, like, we're still waiting. It's like, I want to be out touring this record, but like, we haven't been able to start committing to booking anything. So you're like, well, I'm waiting again. Like, So it's it's very funny to have an album out, have it out. It feels really good, and but yeah, so it just got so meta. Everything became about the theme of the album.
You mentioned the Mint Records thing there, and I wasn't quite certain about that. Is this just a business, boring, behind-the-scenes business thing, or is there a reason it's not on Mint?
I don't, you know, part of growing is that I think I certainly would have, like, run my mouth a lot about it beforehand. The reality is like, you know, I'm very thankful to everyone I worked with at Mint over the years for what they did for us. Everyone's left a job. You know, everyone's had a job they liked that they left, and I don't want to say it's a job, but, you know, even if you still love it, sometimes the situation becomes untenable for you to continue there. And yeah, I God bless them. I hope it keeps going and everything keeps going well. But the community I made through Mint was like so important to me and music. And yeah, I'm like, I'd never want to say anything bad against them. And also, I was very excited to be having this opportunity and like to work with Bobo Integral. Like when we started talking to Gonzalo, who runs that label, who also has a fantastic band I love called Boys of Perpetual Nervousness. So like the Feelies reference point we both have. I think that label just puts out so many amazing records. So for me, it's like a label that's put out, you know, the first Ducks Limited record put out. I love the Elricman record they put out. It's so great. And Boys of Perpetual Nervousness records, Field School, a band from Olympia that I really like. The Motorist record, of course, Jesse had used to play drums in that band as well. It's like so many albums that I really love. It's like such a great label, and his enthusiasm for the record, like he would came in and was just like, these are the singles, this is what we do, like I love it, like this is it. It's been really, really nice and sort of exciting, and maybe part of that is like why not just change it up and like work with someone someone who wants to do it. And yeah, it's been really nice, and I've seen it like getting into circles that maybe we weren't in before or other places, and like it's very exciting. We've never toured Europe, so we're stuck on it, but we're trying to get that together and go over and play shows. Yeah, it's great. One door closes. I went Desperate Bicycles. One door closes, another shuts. In theory, one should open.
Yeah.
But.
Well, congratulations. You seem like you're in a good place. So that all sounds good. It all sounds positive. Oh. You mentioned European touring. King of the Segways here again for you, everybody. What's coming up next for A Tough Age at this point? I wanted to ask about road work, if that's something that's forthcoming, and also if you're already working on new stuff. Can you talk about those things?
Yeah, I want to tour really badly, but it's become a very hard landscape to tour as someone without a booker. We do not. I've always just booked our tours. And again, that sort of level we're at where we're a lot of people perceive us as being like not too big to play small shows and then too small to play big shows. I'm like, oh, where are we stuck at? I'm like, do you know that I used to just move 200 comic boxes out of the way and set up a PA so I could throw punk shows where I paid the bands all the money?
Yeah.
And I've been doing that for 30 years.
Yeah.
Please. But also because I'm getting older, a lot of my peers or people around me either got successful or hung it up.
Yeah.
So booking is hard because I'm sort of almost starting from zero, even though you've booked 5,000 shows for other bands, all your contacts are gone.
Yeah.
So I was trying, and it's been really, really difficult. We want to be touring like tomorrow if we can. Okay. So I'm hoping that the bigger thing's coming. We're trying to get some smaller things together. We went and played Sled Island again, which had been a long time for us and was such a great show, and such a great show in Calgary. Like, I do want to come back and do Calgary Edmonton pretty soon because it's there and it's easy to do. But yeah, we're hoping to get it going. Europe, in theory, later this year. We're working on that. Worst case, early next year. But I want to get over there for Gonzalo. You know, like, we owe him putting out the record. I want to be there and supporting it there. Yeah, we had our friend Wade join the band, so we are working. We got, like, an album worth of stuff already. And it's seeing what sticks, throwing some away. But working on that and on this new setup with the four-piece has been really exciting to have that. So yeah, I'm just like, just keep the train moving. Like I always say, like, you just got to keep going, even if you end up sort of like, you know, It's like you get to the airport early. Make sure you're prepared. Get to the airport early, and then maybe your flight gets delayed. But
sure,
you'll get on that plane eventually.
Sure. Yeah. Well, that's great. I'm happy for you, Jared. And I'm glad we've had this chat. If people want to learn more about Tough Age, where would you like to kind of send them using the things that we use right now?
Huh. Well, and thank you so much for having me on. I really appreciate it, and it's always a pleasure. So nice to see you.
Oh no,
again.
It's absolutely my pleasure. And for all our belly aching about the demise of Twitter, this was because you tweeted out.
Yeah.
Does anyone want to talk? I want to talk about my music, and I was like, sure, let's do that again. And then here we are. So
yeah, thank you. I'm
close to leaving the. I want to leave the platform, but I'm not sure.
Yeah,
as someone who needs to promote things all the time, if that's a wise decision exactly. But anyway, lovely that worked out and so quickly. I feel like we were just corresponding about this last week.
Yeah.
So Twitter is maybe one.
I'm around Twitter, destiny. Yeah. I'm running into the ground, and I am not moving a blue... I'm not going to go on some other rich person's horrible format.
It's the same guy. I'm on it now. I got an invite from my friend Rolly, Cadence Weapon, on the weekend, and I'm like, all right, fine. I better get on it before I can't. And now I got to start all over again. I got very few followers, and I'm like, I have all of them. I have Hive and Mastodon. I've got them all. I'm not using them. And so we'll see. Maybe we're all done. I don't know.
Yeah. I'm like, I'll run into the ground, and when it's gone again, I'm like the bliss of forgetfulness will be on us. And that's there's paradise by another name. That's it. It's like accepting
that's right.
the demise of something. You're like, the end of something is just like a bliss in that way. So, but we are still on there. I'm running my mouth, giving my opinions. We're on Instagram, of course. The other rich person's platform, Tough Age Band. And I'm doing some oversharing right now about the process behind the songs on this record. I just started on this week. We have no PR, so mostly it's just me talking on these platforms. But, listen to it. Buy it if you want. If you don't want, it's still, music has been devalued to be free. Mm-hmm. In one way, that's very great. It's very accessible. So you know what? Go listen to it on Spotify. Maybe then someone will book us on a tour. You get enough listeners there, they're like, oh, this band's pretty good.
Yeah, I guess that's true. Yeah. I took my show off of Spotify, and I just found out as we're speaking, it got back on there through some feed thing, and I'm trying to get rid of it again, get it off of there, because I don't like the company, but that's neither here nor there.
Oh, yeah. They are not great, but it's you're tied to all these things, and that's, I'm like, oh, I'm going to be like, Apple Music, like Tidal, like...
Yeah.
As somebody gets the payments, I don't know how it is for podcasting.
None.
But,
zero.
Okay. Shoot.
There's no royalties, like, unless you get paid by the companies or you get a lot of ads.
Yeah.
Yeah,
because it's the same for me. I'm like, my way is that I indignantly will never pay for it. And that's how I make my stand. I'm like, I'll listen to your Billie Eilish ad to listen to today's top hits playlist till the cows come home. It's fine. Yeah. But yeah, I'm just around on social media, running my mouth much like this, and the music's all at Bandcamp and Spotify, anywhere you want to stream it. You can buy the record in Canada on We Are Time, which is Jesse and Chandra's label, and then worldwide from Boba Integral. Very accessible. toughageband@gmail.com. Write me. I'll talk to anyone about anything. Said you want to talk about GBV lineups, I can talk about that for a week. It's been great.
I'll link to some of the things you just said. That sounds great. Thank you for being so open and accessible. If we can go out in a song, you did a nice little segue there yourself. I noticed you referenced Paradise by Another Name, but I'm not going to ask a leading question here. Is there a song from the new album that we can go out on, Jared? And if so, can you pick one for us and tell us why you chose it?
Sure, I won't pick that to be just because I'm tough.
Yeah.
But the song "Scattered" is a very important one to me on this record. It ended up again taking on a lot more meaning as it went on, but was a song really about me reconciling with the worst parts of myself, and was also the only exception to my rule when recording, and the only song that we recorded the bed tracks for more than three times because we were like, we got to get it right. So I was very proud of how it all came together. It's really like the three of us worked and worked and got this final product that we were all so happy with. And Peter, the Bottle Garden, wasn't so important on this one too. So it feels the most like representational of this thing I said, where like it couldn't have existed without Loren, Jesse, Peter, and I all working on this song at the same time. So, yeah.
Well, and pondering the lyrics, it does seem to be a song where you're addressing yourself. The use of you is really maybe you.
This one is definitely me, yeah.
Okay, talking to yourself in a way. I suppose. So let's dig deep, everyone listening, on maybe some of these lyrics, just to pick up on what I'm going to leave it vague and let you guys figure it out. This is a great song called Scattered by Tough Age from their beautiful new album, Waiting Here, obviously available now. Jared, always a pleasure to speak with you. Thank you for making time for me on my show. It really means a lot, and I hope we speak again soon. Best of luck in the future.
Thank you. Everything you just said, repeated. I appreciate it so much, Vish. Thank you so much for having me.
Trying to get along yourself, easy said than done. Leaving something out that's gone. Waiting just outside, waiting just outside, waiting just outside.
Very nice to have Jared back on Creative Control, this time for the 797th episode of the show to talk about Tough Age. That was fun. This show is part of the Entertainment One podcast network and is available wherever you get your podcasts, pretty much. If you can't find an episode that you've heard about and you're looking for it, or you want to learn more about me and sign up for my monthly newsletter, which I'm several months behind on. I'm sorry. It's just been a busy time. You know, I got a new job. I got a new job, like a day job. It's not really, I don't like to talk about my job too much on the show, but, you know, I had to get a new job. It's been a busy time. You don't need to hear about that. Anyway, it's taken a while for me to write a newsletter. I'll do it soon. Anyway, if you want to learn about all that stuff, go to my website, vishkana.com. And like Creative Control on Facebook or follow the show on Twitter at vishcreative, or you can follow me on Twitter and on Twitter and Instagram, at Vish Khanna. I'm also on Blue Sky and Mastodon and TikTok and all the other things, too. But you just have to find me. It's just look for Vish Khanna, and there are other Vish Khannas. You might be surprised, but there are lots of us. But I'm me, and you know who I am. You'll figure it out. Anyway, follow me if you want. Also, please visit patreon.com/creativecontrol to make a flexible monthly donation to keep this podcast running. $6 American or more a month grants you access to exclusive content. And if you're interested in receiving a Creative Control t-shirt, you can message me on Patreon. If you're at that $6 range there and above, I'll get you one while supplies last. Now, you don't have to donate $6, whatever amount you can afford. It could be more, it could be less. You can change it at any time. That's the beauty of it. So please, if you can, support Creative Control on Patreon today. It means a lot. Thank you. Thanks again to the excellent Alberta record store, Blackbird Music. They have locations in Edmonton and Calgary, Alberta, and a great website where you can order things. It's blackbird.ca. You could order the new Tough Age record. Waiting here. Why not? You just heard us talking about it. Well, go there and get it. That's one way to get it if you don't want to get on Bandcamp or whatever. So yeah, support local record stores if you can, like Blackbird Music. Also want to thank Pizza Trocadero, The Bookshelf, and Planet Bean Coffee, respectively, in Guelph, Ontario, and Granddad's Donuts in Hamilton, Ontario, for their in-kind support for this show. Thanks, as always, to my friend Jim Guthrie for letting me use some music of his on this show. You can learn more about Jim at jimguthrie.org. And finally, thank you so much for listening to this episode with Jared from Tough Age. I hope you enjoyed it. I hope you'll consider subscribing to this podcast or following it and telling your friends about it, and maybe they'll do the same stuff that you do. That would be appreciated. Otherwise, I will talk to you soon. Listen to Tough Age. Buy their records. Be well. Bye for now.